স্যার, গুড ইভিনিং স্যার, কামরা স্যার। আমরা স্যার సార్, గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ సార్.
రాజశేఖర్ గారు గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ అండి.
సార్, అది మిమ్మల్ని కోహోస్ట్ చేశాను సార్.
ఓకే, థ్యాంక్ యూ అన్న, థ్యాంక్ యూ.
ఓకే సార్, ప్రియదర్శన్ మేడం ఫోన్ నంబర్ లేదు సార్ నా దగ్గర. అది ఉన్నది ఉన్నది ట్రై చేస్తే అది కనెక్ట్ అవ్వట్లేదు సార్.
ఎప్పుడు కాల్ చేస్తారు?
అనిల్ అనిల్ది ఓకే, అనిల్ అనిల్ చెక్ చేశాను సార్.
ఓకే ఓకే,
సరే
కాల్ చేస్తారు.
సరే సార్, థ్యాంక్ యూ.
గారు ఒకసారి లాగిన్ అయ్యారా? అవండి అవండి. ఓకే ఓకే, ఆల్ ది బెస్ట్.
ప్రియదర్శిని మేడం మేడం మిమ్మల్ని అన్మ్యూట్ చేశాను
ఆ ఓకే సర్
ఒకసారి
సర్ వినిపిస్తుందా సర్
ఆ వినిపిస్తుంది మేడం వీడియో కూడా ఆన్ చేసుకోండి మేడం
ఒక్క నిమిషం ఫస్ట్ వీడియో హలో
ఆ మేడం మీరు కనిపిస్తున్నారు
ఓకే సర్ యాక్చువల్లీ వైఫై ప్రాబ్లం ఉంది సార్ ఇది
అవునా
సార్ ఆడియో బానే వస్తుందా సార్ వీడియో ఉన్నా
నే మేడం
ఓకే సార్ అయితే
మేడం వీడియో ఆఫ్ చేసుకోండి తర్వాత
ఓకే సార్ ఓకే
మేడం గారు రెడీగా ఉన్నారా మేడం గారు రెడీగా ఉన్నారా మేడం గారు మాట్లాడండి
హలో సార్
ఆ మీ వాయిస్ క్లారిటీ కొంచెం మాట్లాడండి
సర్ వినిపిస్తుందా సర్ వాయిస్
ఆ వినిపిస్తుందండి ఒకసారి వీడియో ఆన్ చేయండి మీరు వీడియోలోనే ప్రెజెంటేషన్ ఇవ్వాలి
సర్ ఆన్ చేసాను
ఓకేనండి
ఓకే సర్
ఒకసారి మాట్లాడండి వామ్ వెల్కమ్ చెప్పండి ఒక టైం ఉంది
హలో
ఓకే రాజశేఖర్ గారు ఇంకా రిసోర్స్ పర్సన్ రాలేదు కదా
రాలేదు సార్
వస్తే కోహోస్ట్ చేయండి
సరే సార్ సరే సార్
520 సార్ వస్తారన్నారు
ఓకే సార్
Thank you. హలో 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 హలో
కెమెరా సార్ మీది వినిపెట్లేదు సార్ వాయిస్ మైక్ ఆన్ చేసుకోండి సార్ మ్యూట్ చేసుకోండి
సార్ సార్ గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్ సార్
గుడ్ ఈవినింగ్
కస్టమరీ దేర్ ఇస్ ఎ ఇంట్రడక్షన్ పార్ట్ బిగినింగ్ అండ్ దెన్ యువర్ లెక్చర్ బిగిన్ సార్
సార్ మై వాయిస్ ఇస్ ఆడిబుల్
yes yes ఆడిబుల్ సార్ యువర్ ప్రెజెంటేషన్ ఆల్సో విజిబుల్
ఓకే ఓకే గుడ్
సర్ పూల్ పెట్టమంటారా సార్
పూల్ పెట్టండి ఆశేఖర్ గారు
yes sir
పూల్ పెట్టండి
ఓకే ఓకే సార్ డియర్ పార్టిసిపెంట్స్ హియర్ ఇస్ ఎ పూల్ రిగార్డింగ్ ద ఆడియో సో ఇఫ్ ఆడియో ఇస్ క్లియర్ సే yes ఇఫ్ నాట్ సే no ఐ రిక్వెస్ట్ ఆల్ ద పార్టిసిపెంట్స్ టు డు దిస్ పూలింగ్ I request all the participants to please pull for your audio clearance. Pradeep sir, akkada annotation off chesukovali sir paina ok sari off chesukondi ante annotation byte all chestunnaru sir పైన షేర్ పైన అక్కడ 3 డాట్స్ ఉంటాయి సార్
జస్ట్ ఎ మినిట్
అక్కడ పార్టిసిపెంట్స్ అనోటేషన్ చేయకుండా మనం డిసేబుల్ చేయొచ్చు సార్
సార్ యాక్చువల్లీ తెలుగు కెన్ యు టాక్ ఇన్ ఇంగ్లీష్
స్పీక్ ఇన్ ఇంగ్లీష్ రాజశేఖర్ గారు
ఓకే ఓకే సార్ ఓకే
స్పీక్ ఇన్ ఇంగ్లీష్
ఓకే సార్ అవుట్ సైడ్ మిస్ పార్టిసిపెంట్స్ ఆర్ డూయింగ్ ది అనోటేషన్ సార్
ఓకే
సో ఆన్ ద టాప్ సార్ వేర్ యు మేడ్ ద స్లైడ్ షేర్ ఆన్ ద టాప్ సో దేర్ ఆర్ right side there are 3 dots sir
correct
so if you click that one there is a disable annotation by the participants so you please enable that one sir
okay
so then the participants cannot annotate
okay okay that I have done
sir still it is there sir so you can just clear that one have you got that one sir
actually now there is an option coming allow participant to annotate so that I have disabled actually sir
then there is a clear annotation also is there sir
yes
you click on the annotation sir there the after the pause button there is an annotation button sir on the top only
annotate
so if you click that one
pause share karna hai pause annotate
नहीं नहीं सर ये एनोटेशन को क्लियर करना है सर क्लियर
एनोटेट में देयर इज ऑप्शन कॉल्ड क्लियर करेक्ट
क्लियर क्लियर ऑल ड्राइंग विल बी देयर सर
हां 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 करेक्ट
यस सर
थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू
राजशेखर पुट इट सेकंड पोल
ओके सर
स्टार्ट द फर्स्ट पोल
पार्टिसिपेंट्स आई एम पुटिंग द सेकंड पोल regarding the video clearance so the video is clear say yes if not say no I request all the participants to give poll.
Stop the poll.
Okay, sir.
Now, Rajshekhar garu, please proceed.
Okay, sir. I welcome all the participants for this third day on this knowledge development program. Now, I request Priyadarshini madam, associate assistant professor of EC department, to introduce our today's chief guest, Pradeep sir. Priyadarshini madam.
Okay, sir. Thank you, Rajshekhar sir. Good evening to one and all. Myself is Priyadarshini, working as an assistant professor in ACE department in Gudlawadar Engineering College. It's my immense pleasure to introduce the speaker of today's session, Engineer Pradeep Kumar Diksena, scientist study working in Anurag Laboratories, DRDO, Hyderabad. About his educational qualifications, Mr. Pradeep Kumar completed BE in Electronics and Telecommunications Engineering from RIT Raipur in the year 2005. He secured 175 rank in GATE exam in all over in India in the year 2006. He completed ME in Microelectronics System from IISA Bangalore in the year 2011. So about his career, he started his career in 2006 in DRDO. His working area is analog mixed signal and RF VLSI design. The main interested area of Mr. Pradeep Kumar, high speed ADC and DAC designing, fractional NPLL design, signal conditioning circuit design, high frequency and RF circuit design. He is very much expertise in working in different tools like cadence customized design tools, layout design tools, mixed signal design tools, Verilog, VHDL, visual basics, FPGA system design, IC testing and verification. He had good number of publications in both technical, in both conferences, international and national conferences. He also published 5 technical papers in various conferences conducted by DRDO. So with this introduction, I welcome Mr. Pradeep Kumar Diksena garu to proceed the today's session.
Thank you, madam. Thank you to
that. Thank you.
Nice introduction. So, Mr. good evening to everyone. And it's good to give a lecture in this kind of digital and online platform. So this is also my first experience to giving on this online thing. So I would also like to thank to all the principal and the participants from the colleges and Dr. and especially Dr. Inkam Raju for the invitation. So thank you very much, sir. So shall I start anybody and anything? So before.
Yes, sir, you can start, sir. Please proceed.
Okay, thank you. So, as you heard in my resume also, basically my most experience is in analog RF and mixed signal IC design. So basically in DRDO, we are basically working for the defense application. So as this talk is mostly about the IoT as well as I and all. So I thought that I will basically share on what my experience on this fields. So basically Anurag in that lab is situated in Hyderabad, which is basically working on the high performance computing and wireless. Basically, these are the two main area. So, and I am working in field of analog and RF LSI. So if you see in the defense, a lot of applications which will also require this type of LSI design application. So for that purpose, our lab is working. So mostly our ICs are related to defense application. I kindly say, request all the participants do not record or do not share this PPT, because mostly things are confidential kind of thing, but to make the understanding, I will just give the brief. If you want something, I will give a material to you. So I will share one material, which is part of this PPT that you can share amongst you. So that is okay, Mr. N.K. Raju sir. So, okay. Then let me start the first, I will just, so, this is my, this one, basically outline. So basically first, I hope everybody knows it's a basic art there in electrical and electronics, and they have background on some kind of BJT CMOS. Anyhow, I'm going to cover all this BJT CMOS technology, so you will understand better how basically from scratch the VLSI has to be done. So basically, there is a two domain. One is analog and digital in a broad area. So basically, digital design will basically start from the gate level, but this analog design basically that will start from the CMOS level. So if you want to do any analog or any RF VLSI design, basically you have to understand the functionality of MOS. Then only you can do become a designer. So basically, my outline is like this. So basically, I'm first going to introduce what is the analog, then how what is integrated circuit basically. Then there's two technologies. One is BJT and one is CMOS. So then also there is a three area I'm covering. Basically, one is analog IC design. Then there is a mixed signal design. And then third is a RFIC design. These are the three domains which I am covering in this lecture. So let's proceed for the this thing. So before going to the all IC design, let's first to understand what is analog. So basically, if you see any physical world, whatever we are going to interact, let everything is analog. Suppose you are listening music or listening sound, or you are seeing anything. So everything is analog, but what we will do, so all electronics enter basically the first interface for any physical world, that should be the analog. So mostly, suppose if you are doing any DSP or anything, there should be front will be either analog to digital converter, then at the end there will be a digital to analog converter which will again come to the analog world. In between, we put the digital signal processing. So basically, this is for any electronic system, this kind of things are doing. So basically, real world scenario, like if you go in RF, they mostly are antenna. If you go in a very low analog signal, so basically microphone sensors. Okay, then we do find some kind of signal conditioning in the analog level. Once the signal conditioning, basically the what is the meaning of signal conditioning in analog? Basically doing some kind of filtering, providing some gain to the signal. If any type of noise reduction, that has to be done in the front end. Then the data we convert into the digital domain through our ADC. So ADC is basically analog to digital conversion. Then once we got the data in digital, whatever the processing want to do, if suppose any kind of control system or anything, that we can do in the DSP, like FFT, IFFT, a lot of things can be done in DSP. So basically frequency translation, DSP, processing and DSP. So once we got the what is the output required output, then we convert into the digital to analog converter. So basically this is the flow for any kind of if you see in a system level or you see in a chip level. So all this thing has to be done. So this is the thing. So basically, this is a small basic. Basically, what is the meaning of what is difference between analog and digital? So analog is basically continuous in time and continuous in amplitude. But digital signal is basically quantized in the time and quantized in the amplitude. So like that, we define two domain, analog signal and digital signal. So basically, all the come is a there is a one inherent noise. We'll call it a quantization noise that will be introduced in the signal. So as this quantization noise is mostly related to our ADC. So basically, we assuming some value that continuous, there will be a very fine quantization. We are skipping some value. So basically, we are inherently introducing the noise. So that will be basically a point for the ADC this thing. So basically, any physical signal we can represent in the analog, and then we with this sampling and discrete time doing, we can convert into a digital. So basically, the fact is that the physical signal which are at the continuous in time and amplitude, let's say like a seismic, audio, video, biological, or anything, but digital signal are what is the advantage of digital? So basically, digital signal are easier to process and more robust. Basically, there is more room for error, highest noise immunity. So interface and process. So basically, there are some advantage in analog processing and there are some advantage in digital processing. So what people try to do, what advantage you can get in the analog processing, we do in analog domain. And what advantage is more in digital domain, we do in the digital domain. So that our system will give the optimum output. So that is the thing. So I think this is, I just covered some small history of integrated circuit. Basically, you know that before this our transistor, there is a vacuum tube devices. So then in 1958, Jack Kilby from the Texas Instrument, he created one first kind of a first cut transistor. So then later on, there a lot of innovation has been done on this transistor. Now we are going to see the like of VLSI circuit. So for this in Ocean Basin in 2000 between Sir Jack Kelly won the Nobel Prize. So this is give the picture how the VLSI circuit has been fabricated. So this I'll just give the brief means suppose from scratch how the any integrated circuit has been. So basically there are multiple steps involved to design this. So if you see that there are basically there is a silicon P diode. So basically this is our bare silica board what we call. With on top of that we do all kind of fabrication. So the process is called for realizing this circuits is called a fabrication. So basically we create layer by layer what type of pattern we want on the top of silicon. So whereas we generally use photolithography, basically photolithography is to give the idea where we have to want to print circuit and where we want to block the circuit. And there is a two things basically how to there is called implant. So basically we do two things, either diffusion or ionization. So basically diffusion ionization, what it will do, suppose there is a P type of substrate, then we add N type of substrate. So suppose I want to create any BJT. So basically if it is say emitter base and this is a NPN transistor. So how we would create, first we create P type substrate, then on top of that there is N type of diffusion has to be done. For then again we create the P type of base, then N plus type of emitter. So this is a kind of construction in the any kind of integrated circuit. The same thing can follow for the CMOS also. So basically it took almost 20 years after the innovation of this transistor to come to actual circuit realization, because there are a lot of issues to involve in this fabrication and a lot of issues to means how we create the integrated circuit. So slowly people got some innovation in the there how to do the fabrication. There are a lot of problems are there because earlier what people are generating silicon, there are a lot of impurities are there, so they're not able to get perfect semiconductor. Then there is a problem of deposition, photolithography. So slowly with time people have solved all this problem and they come to the new state. So there are elements. So basically today the silicon sulfide is so well understood that we deliberately place a change and the oxide here. Basically, because it's a complementary. So what is doing N, the other thing is doing kind of P. So that's why we call it a complementary. So if we go very basic characteristic, so there are any circuit, there should be two things to be defined. What is the proper current? What is the voltage for that thing? So this is the kind of MOS. So basically, if you see, there is a one gray area, this we call it a gate. And there is a two area, we call it a source, and we call it a drain. So basically we apply some, so basically in a analog domain and digital domain, what is the difference? Every time, everywhere we are using as a MOS, but the basic difference in digital, we use this as a switch. In analog, we use this transistor as an amplifier, or some kind of a gain. So basic operations are same, but only the operation that is defined by the operating point. Which operating point we are working, that is defined by the our what is the gate potential and the voltage between. You see the below plot. It's a basically plot between drain voltage, basically VDS versus ID. But this ID current is depend that will be defined by the this potential on the gate. So that potential we call it VGS. But there is also something called a threshold voltage. So so after some threshold voltage, this transistor actually go into the saturation. Before that, it will work as a linear resistor. So the and this also depend on the what is the W by L. So what is W, what is L? Basically, if you see this channel, so the so basically in broad what we call there is a the basically distance between source and drain. Okay, source and drain, there is a distance that we call it a channel. Okay, and later and this source to discharge channel, and there will be a width. So if we go in the 3D dimension, you will see there is a width till this is going to, that we call it W. So if you see the formula, so if W is very high, then there will be huge current. L is very small, there will be huge current. And if you apply very large VGS, there will be use current. So this is the thing. But actually, and after the some point, this we call it a threshold voltage. So VGS, if VDS is greater than VGS minus VT, so then the current will be equated only depend on the VGS. It will not depend on the VGS. So that's why the current we are getting constant value. So this will come more in the analog domain. With digital, we just use just a switch. So if VGS is greater than some threshold or some noise value, it will go one. Otherwise, if VGS is less than VT, it will be off. So that is the difference in analog and digital, assuming. So basically, if you see, if even though you also learn your BTECs and everything, so there's a two type of things. There is a one is a bipolar and the other is called a CMOS. So earlier people used to design all the circuits using bipolar technology, but now everything is converted into the CMOS technology. So, but there are also some advantage of bipolar which we can't get in CMOS, but there's a disadvantage we can't get in the bipolar. So, so what happened? So bipolar, what is bipolar transistor? So bipolar transistor, why we called it bipolar? So basically there is a two type of current, that's IB, basically it will define by the current. So this is basically current control device. And this is what is this? Basically here, why it's called bipolar? Because the current phenomena is depend on both, really N plus and P plus. Basically both hole and hole flow is also there, and there is a electron flow is also there. That's why I call it bipolar. So both type of charges are flowing. And but CMOS, it is basically voltage control device. So here is only one, basically either electron will flow or hole will flow, depend on what type of MOS we are using. So what is the advantage of bipolar? Basically it will provide low input offset voltage. Basically it will provide very high voltage gain. It's a high output. Basically it is mostly a current control. So it provides a lot of beta and basically a lot of current gain we are getting. And it's also having, because this having very low value of capacitances. So it can work for the very high frequencies. So basically this bipolar transistor we use for the either for the very high frequency circuit like RF and all, or the circuit where we require very low noise. So that type of circuit we want to use BJT. Okay, now what is the advantage of a CMOS is basically the low power consumption. So basically why the low power consumption? Because it's a basically, if you see here, the base is taking some current because of the IB, but the gate is very high impedance. So there will be no current will taken by the gate. So mostly, so the power compared to this PFLR will be less. And also it provides high package density and high noise immunity. And it's easier design and it's relatively easier for scaling and more suitable for the digital vision. Basically CMOS, earlier people used for only for digital. Slowly now people understand the analog property also. Then now they're integrating analog and digital as well. So that is the advantage of CMOS. So another advantage, CMOS technology, we can integrate everything like RF, analog, digital. So that is good for the CMOS. So CMOS technology for analog. So what is the difference between CMOS technology for analog and digital? So here, what is due to the increase of system complexity, integration of analog and digital function on one chip that we require. So integration of analog building block in CMOS technology demand control on different process step. So analog and so process requirement for analog CMOS technology is what, that basically there should be minimum PN junction leakage. But analog, what we require is a good matching, because mostly we're doing kind of a differential circuit. So basically there for differential circuit advantages that will provide inherent noise cancellation. So but to do that, we require good matching. And also in analog, we use kind of a resistor and capacitor. So the technology should support resistors and capacitor, because we want to implement filter or some kind of PGR, anything. We require this resistor and capacitor. So the technology should support this resistor and capacitor fabrication. And also whatever we are producing, there should be reproducible behavior of different active and passive components. So here we require more precise process compared to the digital, because here we are working on the continuous signal. So a small change in it, suppose there is a small change in your doping or anything, it will give a lot of mismatches. So here require more precise fabrication. And also now it is coming with some bipolar devices also. So what is the analog IC design flow? So basically analog IC design flow, what actually we are doing in our design process. So I want to first, if any system is there, first we have to find out idea how to.
Excuse me, sir. ప్రదీప్ గారు
సార్
ప్రదీప్ గారు జస్ట్ దేర్ ఇస్ సమ్ ఆడియో ఇంటర్ఫరెన్స్ ఇస్ కమింగ్ ఇట్ మే బి నియర్ టు యువర్ ఫోన్ ఆర్ సంథింగ్ ఎల్స్
ఐ థింక్ ఫోన్ ఇస్ దేర్
ప్లీజ్ కీప్ అవే సార్
నౌ ఇట్ ఇస్ గుడ్
నౌ నౌ ఇట్ ఇస్ ఓకే సార్ క్యారీ ఆన్ థాంక్యూ సార్
So the idea is first to get the specification for whatever things can be done. Then next we go for the block level system. So suppose any system, what should be the blocks analyzed, what are the blocks to be involved for the design of getting any particular function. So first we do a block level. Once we define the block level, then we go for the circuit level. So each block, like this, you see here some pan in the transistor level. So then we go for the simulation. So we give some predefined input and found that the desired output is coming. If it not coming, then we tune the circuit. Basically, the tuning in the analog is basically changing the W by L, changing the bias voltages, changing the. A lot of parameters are there. I will explain later. A lot of parameters are there which has to be changed to get the design. So we get the simulation result for the result. So once the things are verified in schematic level, so this we called it the schematic. Then we go to the layout. So basically, what we are seeing is schematic. So there will be actually the physical representation. Basically, this is only symbolic representation. We go for the actually physical, means how it will be fabricated. So then we go for the physical layout. So once that physical layout, then it will go for fabrication, fabricated IC. So once we got the IC, we go for packaging, then we do some kind of evaluation testing and board. First in a chip level itself, do some testing, then go for the prototype board level testing. So we do the this evaluation board design and do, then we characterize the IC with our some in lab experiment with some signal flow generator, waveform generator, and we see what are the output. Then we characterize. We'll put a lot of tuning also, so we can tune a particular parameter. Then finally create a system board, and from that system board it will go for the program. So this picture gives some brief of how the analog IC design has to be done. So actually, if you see all over the world, actually there are only around 20-25% are analog designer, mostly 75% are digital designer. Because there are two things actually. So digital requirements are huge, but it is also a kind of it's once you learn, it's mostly a coding. But analog IC design is not like a coding. It's basically more challenging, and so it really require it's required a good mathematics and good kind of you have to have some skill and so some kind of intuitive design. So I will tell why it is that, because it is challenging. So basically, analog circuits are sensitive to noise, supplies, load, temperature, process, other factor. So that why this is the factors has to be taken care at the time of designing. It required more creativity. So there is no clear logic, because in digital, you have to get either one or zero. So only to apply logic, but here it's not like a one and zero. We have to get some defined signal level and other thing, and it should be insightful and intuitive. So cannot gain from equation or truth table. Because digital, there's a very called a truth table. You can just put the value and find out what I should get has to be implemented. But here, nothing like a truth table. You should understand all the circuit, what is the process, real life continuous time signal, extreme condition, temperature, voltage, how it will be varied. So that has to be taken care in analog IC design. And also, this is state of the art work. So basically, you should also know how the technologies are changing and. How the technology parameters are changing. In digital, you don't bother about technology parameter. You just think everything in a gate, and basically fab will to basically understand all the technology parameter. So basically, here we have to do kind of a lot of skilled engineers required in this. So basically, in digital, we can use lot of right now algorithms are coming, which we just write the C code and they will do the full chip. In analog, that's not possible. There is no synthesis in analog. We can't do synthesis any analog circuit using any compiler or coding. So we have to, for any analog circuit, we have to design the document from the scratch. So ultimately, neither the circuit nor the end products are exciting. basically. So we can tell is this is more kind of adventurous compared to a digital, because a lot of parameters has to be tuned, lot of stuff has to be done. So that is the thing. So what is the activities basically? We define the activity in two domains basically, prefabrication and post-fabrication. So prefabrication basically what has to be done, basically selection of technology, architecture design, basic building block design, then you do some temperature processing, corner simulation, then we do layout verification, then finally we generate the GDS2. So basically what the data we give into the fab, we call it a GDS2, we call it graphical design system. So it's always easy to do that in interchange interface, we call it. And then there is a post fabrication. Once we receive from the packaged, means basically die from the fab, we go for package selection, then we do bonding, then we create the illusion board, then test set of measurement system. And the last thing is environmental testing. So this is the basically activity for any IC designer. So if we go for in any like, just like in digital, there are gates like NAND gate, NOR gate, and so there are also some basic building blocks in the analog. So which is they have each circuit having different rate, because in gates mostly the architecture is fixed. So suppose you want to design one NAND gate, you have to use 2 PMOS, 2 NMOS, and that is over. You can't change that thing. I only do some innovative idea of putting some 3 transistor, 4 transistor, lot of things. But in digital, in analog, for any block you take, you just go for the. Anybody asking question, I will just do clarification, and then that will be okay for everyone. So, because then at the end we can discuss all this thing. What are the issues? So that will be good.
Anyone wants to question, please raise your hand.
People are raising hands, so shall I do that now or at the end we have to discuss, do the discussion? That is the thing actually.
As you wish, sir, as you wish.
Because at the end it will be good, so because then everybody...
At the end it is better, sir. At the end it is better.
So at the end we can do some discussion, so whatever thing, I will clarify that.
Here there is a background noise is coming, sir.
Actually, here it is raining actually.
Okay. Right.
Here raining started.
So. Yeah. Rain sound is coming.
I think it's just the rain.
Your earphones are absorbing very sensitiveness.
Rain started outside actually. But, things are missing or voice is okay? No, sir.
Voice is only. Voice is breaking. Some noise is added to your voice.
Okay, let me try without my this earphone and see.
Yeah.
Better than that.
Try it, sir.
Hello?
Yeah.
Now it is better or earlier it is better?
Take few minutes, sir, then we will decide what to do with it. You carry on.
Because...
Now carry on, sir. Then now it is good. Now carry on.
Okay.
Now it is better, sir.
No, maybe that headphone is a problem. So if any, just see. So basically, the what I'm talking about, the building blocks in the analog IC. So basically, we call these are the some building blocks which generally we use for mostly for all the circuits. If you go for any analog IC design, so basically first thing we call it a band gap reference voltage bias. Basically, for any kind of circuit, we require some kind of voltage and current biasing. So there is a one term called band gap reference. Basically, this is a depending on the technology dependent voltage we something we generate, which will independent of temperature, corner or anything, we should get that current value. So we call it band gap reference voltage bias. Then other things called current source, current mirror, single and differential amplifier, operational amplifier, which will be mostly used, operational amplifier. Then also comparator. There is also one term called OTA. We call it operational transconductance amplifier. And also we design filters, sample and hold. So these are the basic building blocks which we used in our analog IC design. So if you understand this 10 things, so you can do some kind of basic system design in analog. So I'll just give some brief means of how things has been designed in the analog. So if you see in the digital, there's a kind of truth table and you are done, but it's not like here. So here I just giving one example of one op-amp, we call it an operational amplifier. So basically, if you see this one. So this is a basic MOS model. We call it ACE model. So here we also understand AC, DC, and there is a like a RF what thing happen. So there will be different kind of models. So if you go in AC model and if you go for RF model, there will be a lot of capacitance will be added here. So basically in this model, this is basic MOS model. So basically we represent the any CMOS in a, this is a gate, source and drain. So basically now this VGS, what I told earlier, VGS will define the current on the drain. So that factor, we call it GM. That GM is basically the current, this is a voltage dependent current source. So GM, we call it a transconductance. Okay. So this transconductance, so basically the current in drain will define by the current between drain to source. Basically we call it this IDS, is they depend on GM VGS, and there are also some kind of impedance that we call it R naught. So that we define through some equation. So basically this GM, this GM is a very important factor for any analog designer. We call it a transconductance gain. Okay, so basically that will depend on the these factors. So what we factor this is mu and C of, these are the technology parameter, W by L, basically our design parameter, then VGS minus VDS, basically our bias parameter, and 1 plus lambda VDS, basically this kind of a, there's a some dependency of this GM on the voltage between VDS. So basically kind of we call it a loading parameter. So there is, these are a four factor which basically design, we basically decide the GM. So if we go for, this is our two-stage op-amp. So two-stage op-amp, if you see, so why we call it two steps, you see this is our input. So then there is a, this structure. So in this structure, we are giving input to the two MOSFETs. So M1 and M2, two MOSFETs, where we are giving on input. And this M3, V4, we call it a load. Okay. So basically, whatever the this voltage we are giving, that is basically this is a GM device. So GM, what it will do, it will convert V into the basically G, current I out, and this I out will pass through some kind of load. We call this is a current source load. So here this will pass through this load, and again it will generate some kind of voltage in this point. So like this, because this is a differential circuit, so this point and this point, the two voltages will be generated in differential. And finally, this is one another amplifier, we call it a common source. Why it's common source? Basically, we are giving input to the, basically we are giving input to the gate and taking output from the drain, because this is a PMOS, so this is a drain. So the source is a common for both the input and output. So we call it a common source amplifier. So this is a two-stage op-amp. So basically op-amp, what is the requirement? We require some kind of high gain and some kind of a swing. So the first stage, this first stage we use for the gain, and second stage, this second stage we use for the swing. Swing basically what we define is a how much voltage output it can go max and minimum side. So to taking care of this two transistor should be in saturation. Basically in analog design, most important thing, all transistors should be in a saturation for this kind of operation. Saturation means always the VDS should be greater than VGS minus VTH. That condition should be met. At any point, if VDS is going below VGS minus VTH, it will go to the linear region. So we have to make that VDS should be greater than VGS minus VTH. So, okay. Now this high gain. So high gain, so how we are getting high gain in first stage? Basically the first, how we'll calculate the gain, okay. So there is a GM12, one, either one or two. So we call it a transconductance of this transistor. Then there is a load impedance. So there is a two impedance is coming parallel. Either this, if you take RO1, basically you see R0 here, then there is also RO2 here. This is RO3 basically. So either take one or two or three or four. So basically RO1 parallel RO3. So that will become the impedance at this point. So basically when we multiply current with the impedance, basically transconductance with the impedance, we call it a gain actually. So GM into RO parallel. Then the second stage, what we'll do? So basically the transconductance of this transistor, so we call it GM6, GM5 or GM6. Then there will be O impedances, RO5, this M6 and M8. Yeah, 5 or 7. So that parallel. So when basically this will multiply gain with this, so total this will give the overall gain for this op-amp. So generally it come in the range of 50 to 60 dB. What we generally target for our design. So if you want more accuracy or something, then we require higher gain. So if I require accuracy higher than 1% or 0.1%, we go for 80 dB kind of gain we require. So accordingly, we have to design all these transistors, so we'll get that gain. Another factor is what I told, a swing. So basically, swing here defined as this, we call it VDD. So that VGS minus VT factor, we call it VOD. So VOD, this transistor, minus VOD of this transistor. So making sure this two transistor saturation. So remaining part we can use as a swing. So for the proper amplification operation, both should be in a saturation. So what I told, this for designing, there is a kind of, we call this is a octagon for our analog design. So these are the parameter we have to find, parallelly we have to take care for the any circuit. So what are these parameter? Parameters are gain, supply voltage, swing, speed, impedance, power dissipation, noise, linearity. So this all factor has to be optimized. So suppose I want to increase the gain, so there's possibility that the swing will reduce, or they require some higher supply voltage, or my impedance will change. So according to, due to that, linearity will change. So there will be a cross coupling between these parameters. So we have to take care at the time of design how this cross coupling can be avoided, and how to optimize depend on the specification. So I'll tell what are the application where generally we are using in our defense actually. So basically there we are mostly using for the high speed data converter like ADC, DAC. There are a lot of application of ADC and DAC. Then also there is a MEMS sensor mostly we use for our this thing. So basically MEMS is a kind of micro, this is kind of a VLSI, but that is a kind of mechanical domain. They fabricate some kind of a mechanical sensor on MEMS, then we interface with our ASIC, with our electronics. So mostly we do MEMS interface ASIC, then we do physiological monitoring sensor interface. This sensor, we generally use a lot of sensors in the missiles. So there we want to use sensor interface. I will give some example. There's one project we've done, cochlear implant. I will explain later. Then also we want to use for the RF, lot of communication things we are doing with this IC. So these are the applications what we are using in our defense team. So first thing is a data converter. So there are actually a lot of data converter architectures. So I will not, because this, if we go for data converter itself is a some 2-3 days lecture. So I just give the brief. Actually, there are a lot of different kind of architectures available, and depend on different this thing, different application we choose. There is a two thing in a data converter. One is a bandwidth, means a sampling frequency, and another is a resolution. What is the resolution we want? So suppose if we go for a communication application, they will require then more frequency, but resolution will be like a middle value. If we are doing some kind of a display displacement proximity, because the sensors are very low frequency, so and also we don't require much resolution, then we go for low resolution, low bandwidth. But we require somewhere like a temperature or some kind of pressure, we require very precise thing to measure, then we require high resolution, but sampling frequency is low. So there depend on the there are a lot of architectures are there, depend on the application we choose which architecture has to be used. And one thing I explained, that what you are doing is physiological monitoring ASIC. So these are the some IC, what are analog ICs, what you have done for the defense applications. So basically this is a physiological monitoring ASIC. Basically this we which we use for the biomedical application. So basically biomedical ASIC, basically what we want, like a soldier when they are in field, we want to continuously monitor their ECG, EEG. So they can't put big system on top of that. So we created one IC. It will not like a very precise as a lab system, but it will give some kind of idea. So the soldier in proper health condition, or if any degradation are there, there is ECG, is it continuously we can monitor. So knowing the field domains of anything is going rising. So generally when people are in field, they don't know they're exhausting or their blood level rising or anything. So to monitoring the, for one lab, they are working on the system. So we work on this kind of a system. So basically, so the basic building blocks for this kind of system is like an instrumentation amplifier, because here first stage, we should, there are a lot of common mode noises we want to reject it. So we use the instrumentation amplifier, then there is a filter bank, then amplifier, then we use ADC. So finally, this is a block diagram of business. So we design each individual blocks and then integrate it in the chip. Okay, then there is a MEMS interface. So a lot of sensors, if you see in the even the mobile, there are a lot of MEMS sensors are there. Suppose there is accelerometer, and then gyroscope, then there is a proximity sensor. A lot of sensors are there, which are mostly are the current domain or coming in the kind of a MEMS sensor only. So for that, if any MEMS sensor, there is a one electronics is required. So mostly in our lab, we're also depend on application to application, like a pressure sensor or different type of sensor, accelerometer. It's all our MEMS based devices. So we are basically designing the IC's interface IC for that. So this is, I just give one example that there is a one CVC sensor, basically where the, depending on the accelerometer, the capacitances are changing. So we create this IC, so where we first convert this charge to the capacitance to the voltage converter, then voltage to be required some kind of different gain. Then also there are a lot of modulation is happening, so we want to demodulate because of due to this forces of the accelerometer. So then we use some kind of filter. So this is a one interface circuit what we designed for the CVC for MEMS accelerometer. And then one IC we have done for the micro bolometer. So basically bolometer, what we will do, bolometer is basically application, we called it up for like a night vision cameras or IR cameras. So they basically change in resistance will give the idea means how the things are changing in the night, because night we can't see. So there is a called a temperature. Temperature change in the resistance will change the, basically due to change in temperature, the resistance will change. So we want to monitor that change in resistance. We accordingly, we can see the thing. So this is a one kind of implementation we have done for this night vision cameras. We call it a micro bolometer. And also missile, lot of systems are there where we have to use a lot of ADCs and DACs. And some kind of IOs are required and controls are required. So that is thing. Now I will explain one or two how to design everything, but just giving first brief. Then there is a wireless system, communication system. So basically, before going to design, let me tell you, what there is a one domain we call it a mixed signal IC design. So mixed signal, basically what we'll do, basically here everything we like analog, RF, everything will integrate in a digital, integrate in a single chip. But there are a lot of things are there because the digital having different design flow, analog having different design flow. So to interface and to simulate, there are a lot of this thing, challenges are there. So basically, mixed signal IC design, we require, why we require, because there should be lower cost and give the less area in the PCB. And also allow, basically they will allow very complexity not feasible with isolated and not digital sufficient, allow approaches not possible with the separated solution. So basically, if you see what I told you, there is a difference between analog design process and digital design process. So if you see, they have, if you see the checklist in analog design, a lot of checklist is there, but in digital, a lot of things are auto generated itself. So here, digital, everything is a logic. You only just to think about logic, how to be implemented, then everything will done by the computer. Because that is so much complex, nobody can do manual. Nobody can done nowadays. Nobody can do it manually. So only you have to think in term of logic. Then after that, you have to go for system design. Then circuit design is auto generated. Simulation only you have to do. Then circuit layout is auto generated. Top level auto generated. Verification, replication has to be done. But if you see in analog design process, there have to go system design, circuit design. There is no auto generated method for circuit design, component design, circuit simulation. All this has to be followed. So as I told you, the analog design is more challenging compared to the digital design. So basically, mixed signal, what is the problem and something is there. Basically, if you go that analog signal, so analog signal, once you've been mixed signal design, so with digital circuit ingest switching noise. Basically, when there is a digital circuit is mostly doing switching. So that switching noise is basically through substrate or supply, it is coupling to the analog circuit. And also the trend is that 50 to 90% of chip is digital and only 10 to 50% is analog. It depends on the design to design. So basically in a 10% analog and 90% digital, like 10% analog require 90% of total design. So basically, and another challenge is basically digital design in one through, because a lot of verification methods are there for digital. So it will be through by one, one through it will go, but analog it require 2 to 3 iterations to get the perfect result. So, and also the analog design cannot be automated. So there will be no standard cell libraries. Like in analog design, difficult, challenging, always new. So analog design is using IDM. So the problem what I told actually, there is a, when we put both things in a single chip. So there is a lot of crosstalk between these two. So always we analog and digital designer fight to each other that, okay, you put your circuit that side. I want my circuit to be very safe, because in analog circuit, what we want is to be very isolated. There should be no noise should come through anything. And digital fellows, they want to optimize area. They keep here and there the things. So a lot of problems are there. So that's why they don't get along together. So generally for us also to like the situation, but we have to manage all these problems. So then we have to put some kind of proper planning of layout and everything. So basically this circuit is just taken from this IMSC. So the basically the digital, basically they will give a noise generation. So basically it will give more kind of noise, and our analog signal is a noise sensitive. So this too has to be taken care such that this, so there are a lot of techniques too, right? I will just discuss some techniques, means how we can do the integration. So this is the problem basically, what is happening in digital, there's a fast transient. And so basically the switching noise is coming to the analog circuit, the direct, basically digital will more interfere with analog compared to any analog interfere will go to, because if any analog block is generating noise, it will automatically, due to there are a lot of margins are there, noise margin, it will be filtered out. But analog will suffer a lot because there are interaction via the common substrate, direct coupling, so mixed signal icing. So that has to be high complexity logic analog circuit and common chip substrate. So this has to be solved. So what are the solution? Basically what first we do is basically we create, first thing has to be done that analog and digital supply should be separate, because there are a lot of coupling which will happen to the supplies. So if even though doing the PCB also between a lot of digital chips and analog chip, then they do the supply, separate supply. And also the second thing what I do, mostly the analog circuit should be the differential where possible. So that's why any common mode noise will be rejected. And design analog circuit to rely on device matching rather than the absolute parameter. So basically our matching is a more critical, so we have to create some kind of circuit where layout and everything where matching should be matched. Then we put a lot of guarding with respect to process, and then simulate, or we have to simulate a lot of things in post layout simulation is very tedious task, so that we have to done, that has to be done before the fabrication. Otherwise what will happen when we make chip on the, all the digital noise will go to the analog and our, we will can't see an analog output. So that has to be taken very carefully. And a lot of test points has to be taken care of and things like that. So if you see the mixed signal design flow, like I told, now there are different flows are there, because if you go in analog, there is specification, block model, test, bench test, calibration, verification, DRC, LVS. If you go in digital, basically they have to do the RTL, then synthesis, gate level. So these are the basically terms what people are using in the industry. So basically like a STA, we call it static timing analysis, equivalence checking, dynamic verification. So this is a lot of, in a, even though in a layout, we call it, this is a physical design, and in here we call it a layout design. So when we go for the mixed signal, so basically first we partition the design, what will be going to digital and what will be the going to the analog. And accordingly, then analog subsystem and digital best we do the behavioral model. So then we know what that everything will be done properly. Then we do, we create some plan, then simulation plan, test benches, then mix mode simulation verification, then assembly finally at the end. So there will be three designers. One is working on the analog design flow, one will be working on digital design flow, and one should be working on the mixed signal flow. So at the end, whole system can be verified. Final verification will be done by the mixed signal designer. So basically the design flow complex mixed signal SOC start with an idea and ends with a layout. So refine series of specification with user. So basically first we use some kind of system simulator like MATLAB. Then we go for the HDL, MSHDL, we call it a mixed signal hardware description language. And also there somewhere we use the VCS, and we call it a timing simulator. Basically digital we do timing simulation, and we call, and other thing we call it a SPICE. That is a SPICE inspector is our analog simulator. So basically that will be the replical design process. So basically for physical design also same thing. Basically there is a one term we call it a floor plan. Basically floor plans means how the things has to be placed in the chip. Then there's another term called it a verification. Verification basically involves checking the layout, basically to make sure with all the layout. Even though because analog and digital layout has to be done in different platform, then they have to integrate it in a one platform. So there are a lot of LVS and DRCs issues has to be solved. So mostly we are struggling in that, and then we create, because what depend on different technologies and things, it will be changed. Then extracting the circuit from the layout, including layout parasitic and simulating it with a transistor level simulator. So in high performance analog and MS design, the physical implementation often has such an impact on the circuit performance. The layout also must be considered together. So basically we have to create one formal verification plan, then ability to co-simulate the block, constraint definition. So basically digital we define constraints. So basically there are a lot of setup and hold time violation, so that we have to define using constraints. And then there is the last thing is reliability, and the reliable means how the communication, connectivity, constraints, fail safety. So lot of things has to be taken care for any. So basically for chip designing, they'll require a lot of manpower to do all these steps. So for example, suppose they want to do a big chip, you require at least minimum 20 to 30 manpower. If you do each one will do individual task, then also 30 manpower are required. That is the complexity what I'm telling for the chip design. Okay, I will just give one brief actually. There are some projects there which I can share actually. So one project we done, this called a cochlear implantable ASIC that we executed around 2010 to 2012. So basically this is a societal mission. It's not directly related to defense, so that's why I want to share the things here. So basically what is the cochlear implant? Basically this when the mostly people are deaf, because there is one cochlea inside the ear. Okay, so mostly people, this cochlea having some problems, so that's why they want to from birth or due to some accident something, they will become deaf. So these are the people which who can't, by using external amplifier also they can't hear. So this system we designed, so it's like a electrical simulation of our ear. So what we will do is, so basically in this cochlea, what is the cochlea? Basically in the cochlea, there are a lot of tubes are there. So in this tube, there will be different frequencies will be synthesized, and it will be give the electrical signal to the brain. So basically this cochlear implant, so therefore it's called it cochlear implant. So cochlear implant is a surgically implanted electronic device that provide a sense of sound to profound deaf or severely hard of hearing. So basically for the deaf people, is there, it's already proven technology, but in India it is very costly. So if you go for any this thing, because the technology is developed in outside, so they are charging around something around for each year, it's around 14 lakhs to kind of charges there. So then our higher ups are thinking, let's create something kind of an Indian version, so that charge. So after doing all this development, now charge will reduce to be around 1 to 2 lakhs. So our Indian economy, people can easily afford that, including operation and everything. So that we want to do in this thing, because now chip will be kind of very free. Suppose chip, only advantage with chip actually, once we realize any chip you do for mass production, each chip will cost only 100 to 200 rupees. If our designs here, because if our design, this NRE charges only more, otherwise chip charges are very less. So that we want to do, that we want to achieve with this project. So basically, this cochlear implant does not amplify sound, but work as a directly stimulating any functioning auditory nerve inside the cochlea with electric field. So it works by the frequency placement mapping. So basically, in this ASIC, what has to be done? There will be a one microphone which will pick up the audio signal from external thing. Then there will be a one DSP speech processor which will convert the audio signal into the electrical signal. Then we create one RF link between. Basically, this is implanted inside our skull. So it will be complete. It's not, there is no opening. So what we will do, we create one RF link, like we put one magnet and stick this two magnet. One is inside, there is a coil and outside coil will stick together. So for this link, it will be, the data will be transmitted. The another challenge in this, because since this is implanted, we can't put like a battery every time and we have to change the battery and everything. With that we can't do. So we have to create a circuit so which can generate power itself. So there's like you heard about that energy harvesting. So here through RF, we are doing energy harvesting. So once the chip will be implanted, it will harvest energy from the outside. So there will be no internal batteries is there. So that are the challenges for them to begin. So basically then they are receiver and stimulator securing the bone beneath the skin, which convert the signal into electrical impulse and send them through an internal cable of electrodes. And there is an array of electrodes going through the cochlea, which send the impulses to the nerve in the directly to the brain. So basically, this is what I'm telling. This is a cochlea. So basically, in this cochlea, each part of this cochlea will basically, it's like a filter. So each part of cochlea will respond for different frequencies. So the ear will, for high frequency, this part will respond. For very low frequency, this frequency will respond. And accordingly, it will send the stimulation to our brain. So like that, then our brain will combine on the signal and it will give the sense of hearing. So that we want to replicate using some electrodes. So what we will do, in cochlea, we'll put one electrode, array of electrode inside this, in this cochlea, and we'll make such that filter that each will respond for the different frequency. That will do for the external digital processing. Then we send a signal such that this will be the respondent. So this you see there external. So basically, if you see this, this is for high frequency, it will only respond to the this corner, and if you go for low frequency, it will respond to the high frequency. So this is the basic idea behind this. So do we call it select? So if you see, this is the complete picture. So there is one speech processor, capture sound, convert to digital signal. Then there will be a process send digital signal to the internal implant. Then internal implant turn the signal into electrical energy, sending it to an array inside the cochlea. Then electrode stimulate hearing nerve by passing damaged hair cells, and then brain perceives signal your sound. So this is the full concept. So basically, to generate this OSIC, what we heard, this is the kind of, first we generate some kind of specification what we want and what blocks we require. So this is the thing basically. So first we pick some kind of a numerical value, okay, what we want and all this thing. So first we fix targeted that the supply voltage, okay, we supply voltage will take 1.8 volt. So accordingly, we define our technology, okay, this technology should support this much supply voltage. And also there is some data rate that is already with some research people had done this. So the data rate is required. What is the, then we put some 1 megahertz and 2 megahertz clock. Basically internal clock is also required, and decoding of serial communication data, generating differential signal variable impedance. So basically each electrode having different impedances. So we have to give some, professor provide some kind of programmability. They depend upon person to person. So they have what type of liquid, what type of skin, or what cochlea they have. The impedance will be vary. So we want to put some programming, and then also the current, how much current you want to pass, and what is the 1000 per second data rate. And basically inside we have to generate this much voltage, 12 volt. Why? Because suppose we want to generate this 1 milliampere current, and if there is a 10K load, correct? So what voltage you have to apply is around 10 volt. So we have to create some kind of scenario where we can generate 10 volt. Assuming there is a no battery inside, we have to generate 10 volt inside air, which will pass on through the 10K to give, generate the energy. So that kind of challenge is here. So this will show some block diagram. So there will be speech processor, then RF link. Then this will go to the, our first is a power recovery. The power recovery basically kind of your demodulator, or you call it a ST demodulator. So which will generate the rectifier. And for high voltage, we use charge pump LDO, digital LDO, analog LDO. Then we generate. So then also through that, also we do the data and clock recovery. And then if everything will, through this will generate this voltages, high voltage charge pump. And then there is this data will go to the digital controller logic. Okay, and this will go to the level setup. Then it will go to the switch matrix, which we just to be on. Then this output will go to the electrode, and also to know what is the electrode impedance and all, there will be a reverse telemetry, we call it. Through this, it will again go back to the speech processor. So this is a full, this is a block diagram which we implemented inside the chip. So the signal when we come, so finally this kind of signal and it will go to display. So this I'm just showing the final how the chip look like actually. So this is the our complete layout. So this is the kind of band gap, clock, band, switches are there. So like that we are doing power management, voltage, ESD, every lot of things are there. And this is the complete system actually. So this is now for lab testing. What we have done, we put some kind of DSP, and then we pre-created coil. And this is final our chip. This is the chip. So if you see the size actually, size is only 19 mm by 14 mm, this board size. And this finally fit inside this box, and this is the coil, and these are the electrodes. So very small size actually. And this kind of signal we generating, and this we tested in lab level everything. Now, not is we are doing human trials on that. So till this is a cochlear implant. So I just do the brief idea, means how the system has to be designed, what type of activities are involved, a lot of packaging and a lot of size constraint, everything has to be done at the time of design process. And they see the layout, a lot of complexities are there. So we have to fit such that things should be work properly, all has to be properly simulated. Okay, now in a defense application, mostly we are using for telemetry. So basically telemetry, what is the telemetry? Basically, it's like a process by which object characteristics are measured and result transmitted to distant person. So basically when we do some kind of missile trials and all, we are putting a lot of sensor in the missile. and we want to measure what is the temperature, what is the pressure inside the missile, and anything means basically how we monitor what is happening inside the missile. So we put a lot of sensors in the missile, and we put kind of a digital signal processing in that, and then we send that data to our ground stations. So basically, climate data we use basically propulsion control against premises. So basically, what is the use basically climate data is only using detecting failure or underperformance of subsystem. So incorporating the necessary change in subsystem so the optimum performance happens. So this is basic. So basically, there is sensor system, signal conditioning, multiplexing, telemetry. Then there is a data. Finally, we'll get at the ground station amplifier, telemetry receiver. So this like that we see what is happening. So for this there is a requirement. We have to generate some multi-channels this thing. So we created a chip for that, where we use lot of instrumentation, amplifier, op-amps, filters, digital logic. So that basically, and also the sensor has to be excited on chip power management, gain offset. A lot of things has to be taken care inside the chip. So I'll give some basic idea. So what has to be done basically, this like a low noise amplifier, because there are a lot of sensor which require like sensitivity is used, and there will be a lot of noises are there. So our operation amplifier should introduce very low noise so we can achieve the accuracy. So basically it's required to achieve high frequency, maximize the signal gain as close to the input as possible. Input stage will contribute to the noise of the opening. So basically the first stage generally tell is a higher, should be very high gain, it should be very low noise. So, and also the CMOS, there is one problem, call it a flicker noise. So we call it a 1 by f noise. So if we are working at very low frequency, this 1 by f noise will be dominated. So we have to design circuits such that this 1 by f noise should be avoided. And also there is thermal noises will always be there. So basically there are some 2-3 techniques are there. Generally either we use PMOS circuit which are having reduced 1 by f noise, or use some BJTs which also don't have 1 by f noise. Basically this 1 by f noise is problem of MOS, not for the BJTs. So, and there are some techniques, circuit techniques. So that depends on the designer, what type of things you want to use. So there, I told you that there are 3 options for only to reduce 1 by f noise. Either I have to use PMOS input, or I have to go for the BJT, or I have to go for some circuit techniques. So basically the noise, for any noise design, we have to understand the noise. So basically in any circuit, there is a resistor. So we define the noise in a term of this thermal noise. We call it 4 kT R delta F. So there's a R value, so that is depend on the T. So depend on T, because this depend on T, we call it thermal noise. And also there will be, so that's why that value defined due to the random thermal motion electron generated by resistance. So we call it N log KT by 1 milliwatt. So basically the standard value is -174 dBm. Also there is a, in transistor, we call it a short noise. This is due to the particle like nature of charge carrier, because a lot of charge are charge motion is happening here. So due to the charge particle random in charge particle, we call it a short noise. So the value basically is IEN square. Then also this flicker noise component, that will flicker noise that is depend on the 1 by F. So we call it a VN square KW. Basically we have to understand all this formula because this formula has to be used for a circuit design. So how it is made? So finally you see that it is depending on the WL, and this is depending on the R. This all are circuit parameter. And what is the bandwidth has to be fixed. So that has to be taken care of. So you see here the model means how for any transistor, how the MOS will, what type of noise will from any MOS will get. So if suppose this noise is what will model, there is a one noiseless and there is a one noise source separately. So this noise will depend on the GM of this. So we call it 8 KT GM by 3. And there is another noise that it depend on the this factor, flicker noise. So that is depend on the ID, COX and L. So this factor is the, this is noiseless and this is the noise model actually. Even if you go for gate voltage, here also the VGS is there. So that what we will do, we will define this noise input referred. We call it input referred. So what we will do, we will define current and divide by the gain. So mostly the noise we define in term of square, voltage square, basically it's kind of power. So, but it's a bandwidth dependent also, we define in the volt square. So then we divide by GM square. Finally, we'll get the input referred noise is 8 KT by 3 GM plus AF. So basically, this is the noise. Why I'm telling all this noise? Because to understand how we going to design the low noise. Just earlier, I shown the op-amp architecture. But same op-amp, we want to design for the very low noise. So what parameter we have to think in the mind to designing all this? So that factor is there. So this I am showing for the op-amp how the noise, you see the complexity in our design actually. So for each transistor, we will consider the noise, equivalent noise. And finally, we will see total overall noise, how this all this input noise are converting. So to see means how we are going to design this op-amp for low noise, we have to understand these equations and do some kind of approximation and all these things. So if you see finally equivalent noise, we are getting 2 En square GM3 by GM1, En3 cube by En square. So this is a complex equation, but I only kept to show you the complexity because this we have to parameter, each parameter we have to see in the simulation and everything. And we have to decide, because we have to, now you see the variables, total variables here. Basically, the first is a variable is all the W by L is a variable. So we have to understand which W by L to fix based on what. So the that is the noise consideration. So you see the total, finally we come to this formula. Only if we take 1 by F noise, so this formula will show how to reduce the 1 by F noise. And if I only consider thermal noise, this formula will show how to reduce the thermal noise. So what basically, what I told earlier, you know, that PMOS input transistors having the less K basically flicker noise compared to the, so basically we select mostly for the low noise circuit PMOS input. And also we choose area for the input transistor will be large, WN L1 should be large. And also here if you see, to reduce the noise, or if you see in this equation, L1 should be less than L3. So this 3, 2, 3, 4 conclusion we get from the equation. So accordingly, then we started designing the circuit. So what will be the L1, what will be, accordingly we choose, because if you see here, for to minimize this, both the noises, we have to increase the L3 compared to L1. So what is L3, L1, I will tell you L3 over. So this is my M1, so length of this transistor, we'll call it L1. And the length of this transistor, we call it L3. So this should be very less compared to this. And this should be very high. So basically, these are, if you go in a circuit, basically this kind of current source devices. So for current, we generally use a large length. And for the gain devices, we use less length. Then accordingly, we define, through GM, we'll define the W value. So that is the process. So where we are using the transistor as a current, there we have to increase the length. So that will make sure two things. First, it will reduce the noise, and second, it will also make sure there will be a perfect matching between these two current transistors. Where we are using for gain devices. So if you see in this op-amp, I will tell you what are the points here. So this M1, M2 are my voltage gain devices. So here L1 should be less, but we have to increase the area. Okay, so W value will be used. Area should be used, okay. And these are the current devices. Then again, if you see, this is the gain device and this is the current device. So accordingly, we have to design L and W. Okay, the other circuit technique, what we call the chopper. So chopper, what it will do, chopper basically, this is a very interesting circuit actually, so for any low noise circuit. So basically, if you see our signal, so this is my signal, let's say low signal bandwidth. Then this is some kind of a noise. So what we will do, we signal, we will just basically what we want to reduce the noise of this A1. A1 is my amplifier. I want to reduce the noise of this A1. So what we will do, we will first convert this low signal to the high frequency. It will go to the high frequency and again down convert using down converter. So this is like a two mixer. So first mixer will convert to the up frequency, then other will convert to the low frequency. But what will happen to the noise? Because we are introducing noise here, when it will pass, it is not passing through the first mixer, it will only passing through the second mixer. So the noise will be converted to the high frequency. It will go to the high frequency. When we down convert, so only the signal will come and noise. So basically now we separated noise and signal. So this is a little complex to understand, but it is like that actually. So my input, I am first converting, then I am amplifying, but my noise is in low frequency for open. Then again I am down converting. The down converting, what will happen, this will go to the this end, low frequency will go to the high frequency. So this will happen. So finally I have pushed the noise to the high frequency, then I will do filtering, so my this circuit noise will be reduced. So this is the circuit implementation. Basically we use switches and all, then we implement that thing. So you see, this is the assumption related result. So basically, with without chopper, we have a noise is here. But with chopper, the noise is this frequency noise is increasing, but here it is reducing because signal of interest is the 0 to 10 kilohertz our input. So without chopper, the noise is here and signal may be here. So we are not able to detect the signal. But when you introduce the chopper, our signal will be still here and noise will go down. And if you further increase the frequency, the noise will still go down. So that there will be optimization, but the circuit should work at that frequency. That is also things are there. So the switches in the chopper stabilization op-amp introduce a thermal noise equal to the KP by sweep. So required two phase non-overlapping clocks and trade-off between lowering one way and introduction of KP by sweep. So basically in our this SIC, what we have done, we put a lot of signal conditioning. Then so for each signal condition, depend on the sensor, we put what type of noise requirements, some are high and low. So accordingly, we put design the circuit. Then we pass it to our muxing, then buffering, then 12-bit ADC. So this like that, we get the final output. Okay, now, so till now, I discuss about the mixed signal and all this thing. Now, let me discuss a little bit in RF. So there in a difference, a lot of RF communications are there, like SATCOM, backhaul, a lot of radios are there people are using and everything. So, but how this RFIC, whatever things has to be done. Because if you see there, once you go to the RF domain, so the parameter will change completely. There we are working for the noise, linearity, gain. Here things will be different. And then even though kind of same, but not terminology will be different. I will just go to that. So basically the field of audio communication has grown rapidly over the past 2 decades, reaching far into our lives and livelihood. So our cell phone surveillance, basically now, if you see our cell phone, it's a very complicated circuit. It's having RFIC, analog IC, digital IC, DSP, everything is there. So you can give this, now the why you are getting good phones and all this is all due to the VLSI. So as the VLSI technologies are improving, a lot of things we are integrating in a single chip. Now chips are coming like that. The chip having all this thing, RF, mixed signal, analog, digital, everything in a single chip. They are putting processor, they are putting the RF down converter, putting ADC, DSP, everything in a single chip. That's why you are getting compact things. So that is the technology advancement. So basically the today's cell phone consists many frequency bands. Also you see that there in RF, we are using multiple things. There is a, because you heard about the GSM. So basically GSM we are communicating on, a lot of things are coming, 3G, 4G, they have different standard. Then also our mobile having Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, GPS, each are having their separate frequency and separate thing, but everything is integrated in our phone. This all are RF stuff. So what is RFIC basically? So basically RFIC, what it will do, what if take the data, so it will process the data and convert into the RF and send to the receiver, and it will do. So basically how we'll do, so basically our voice or data is basically first we do a converter modulate, then we use some power amplifier, then we put in a high frequency, then we transmit, then again the receiver we take, because due to attenuation and lot of interference and everything, we get the signal, and we use some low noise amplifier and down converter, and again we get back the data. So basically transmitter process the voice or data signal and applies result to the antenna. Then receiver has sends the signal, picked up the antenna and processed it to reconstruct the original voice data information. So this is the RFIC architecture. So any chip, basically RFIC, there should be both transmitter and receiver. So in receiver side, LNA, down converter, ADC, then DSP, and transmitter side, there will be a DAC. So this is one RFIC, which will do all this thing. And there are also one kind of frequency. Basically, there's a lot of high frequency things are there. We call it frequency synthesizer. So TX must drive the antenna with a high power level so that transmitted signal is so strong enough to reach the far distance. And also the RX may be sense a small signal. You see, there is a contradictory basically. TX should give very high power and the receiver should sensitive high. So that itself is a challenging to integrate in a single chip, both transmitter and receiver itself. Basement of the building and must first amplify and signal with low noise. So as the technologies are progressing, so the things are basically scaling. So now then we are getting better FT, high frequency circuit. So as the basically this, and so that as the technology improving, our circuits are working with high frequency. So earlier we are working for only we can create a. That's why we are earlier it's 900 MHz. Now we gone to 5 GHz. Now people are talking about 5G, which is 6 GHz. And some people are talking at the 20 gigahertz receiver itself in the CMOS technology. That it is due to the technology scaling. So in receiver, there are two types of architecture. One is called a super heterodyne and another is called a zero IF. So super heterodyne, basically earlier people want to first they convert into the one low frequency. Then it's basically two-step conversion. So there are a lot of challenges in the doing direct conversion in the first earlier circuit, a lot of problems are there. But this type of circuit is not possible in IC level because there are a lot of discrete components and very good filters are required. Now, this filter will be not implemented in IC because they require large Q and all. So that will be not implemented IC. So mostly people for this discrete component, they are using the super heterodyne transistor. This will give very good selectivity and good noise rejection. Still for defense, people are using this kind of architecture. Because here we required a very high sensitivity and all, these type of systems are required. But if we can compromise a little bit on sensitivity and all, then we can go for the zero IR. So it's like a directly RF, it directly comes to the baseband. So this is the architecture, we call it a zero IF, because there is no IF at here. One term we call it, this is a IF, but there is no IF term, so that's why we call it a zero IF, or if we call it a direct conversion. We are from directly, so mostly chip level, this is only implementation is possible. And this is implementation possible in the discrete level, because here we require some little high Q filtering for the image problem, a lot of things. So chip level, we try what are the problems in the direct conversion, we try to solve it itself, which will have some kind of circuit innovation, logic innovation, a lot of things are there, which will help on this. So for RF IC design challenge, basically RF, actually to do any RF design, who are doing RF design, he should expert on all these things. Basically, he should know about the communication theory, he should know about microwave theory, he should know about signal propagation, wireless standards, signal architecture, IC design, CAT. So this is also a multi-domain problem. So RF design draw upon a multitude of discipline require a good understanding of field at seeming irrelevant of integrated circuit, RF circuit and transistor must deal with inverse trade-off. The demand for high performance, lower cost, better functionality. So basically, what are the other challenges? Basically, RF circuit operate at very high frequency, typically between 1 to 5 gigahertz. So why we consider RF as a different domain compared to analog? So what will happen when we go for very high frequency? So then basically, if you see the lambda is equal to C by F. So as F is increasing, lambda is decreasing. So now what happens at high frequency, the lambda will become very small. So when lambda become very small, so it will come in such ratio that whatever the lines we are using in the chip itself, that will becoming as a transmission line. So basically, transmission line basically different point, different impedance and something will happen. So that's why then this picture, RF phenomena will come in picture, because now the wire that carry RF signal must be sought and carefully placed to avoid interference. Now, so RF circuit can be sensitive to interference from signal generated in digital portion of the circuit. Now RF, compared to analog, RF is more sensitive because now the frequency is also high and also we are doing circuit for very high sensitivity and all, then it will pick up a lot of signal from the digital. So the information signal is presented as a relatively low frequency modulation and high frequency carrier. And here we're using a lot of high frequency signal also. So simulating this circuit is expensive because the high frequency carrier necessitated a small time step while the low. So here another challenge is for analog, we are basically working at the 10 kilohertz, 20 kilohertz. So simulation is okay. But in RF, what is happening? Our signal is 20 kilohertz, but our RF is 2 gigahertz. So to see the what is effect in 2 gigahertz, we have and to see the 20 kilohertz period, we have to do very fine steps. So that will take a lot of time for simulation and all. So there are a lot of another techniques to do solve this problem there. We call it RF simulator, separate simulators are there, which will do this kind of analysis. There are different algorithms they are working. Mostly on the frequency domain, they instead of working on the time domain, there we work on the frequency domain. So what are the parameter we define in the RF SDN? Basically, noise figure, non-linearity, intermodulation, sensitivity, input power, dynamic range. So these are the parameters, basically what I told you, there is a different terminology itself will come in here. That we call it like an intermodulation. There is nothing called intermodulation in the analog, but here we have to understand intermodulation. Here we call it resolution, here we call it a sensitivity. There we call it a swing, here we call it a power. Mostly we did here with the power, dynamic range. So this comes. So basically the, there we are just to see the noise. Here we call it a noise figure. Noise figure basically how much external degradation is happening in the when signal passes through a system. So basically this is a basic definition. So if my I pass any RF signal, so how much SNR to dB? Suppose my input SNR is 20 dB, but after doing this, I'm getting only 18 dB SNR. So there is a 2 dB noise figure, 2 dB noise it is the system is adding. So that we call it 2 dB is a noise figure. So basically that ratio SNR in upon SNR out, we will call it as a noise. So basically the adding noise. So if we go for this formula, so basically input signal and input noise are amplified. There is same factor in audition noise in division. And the intermodulation term, but what happened in RF, actually there are multiple signals actually operating at the two different frequencies. And what will happen, there is a non-linearity. In the system, what will happen, the due to this intermodulation component, some signal will again come back to the our desired frequency. So you see here, this omega 1, omega 2. So my this is a desired, but due to the intermodulation, 2 omega 1 minus omega 2 and 2 omega 2 minus omega 1 component will come, which will be inside our signal band, so which will degrade our SNR. So this also has to be, that will depend on the linearity of the system. So due to this non-linearity of the system, these new components are coming, this extra frequencies, which will degrading our SNR. So that has to be taken care in the RF design. So we have to put some parameter to find out what will be this non-linearity this thing. And the sensitivity basically that they will defined by the our noise figure. So so this is suppose the system having some noise figure and we want this much SNR at the output. And this is my bandwidth and this will be the minimum receiver signal power. So the overall signal power is distributed across the channel bandwidth integrating over the bandwidth. So now there we are basically working on the multiplication, but here everything we convert into dB or dBm. So in RF we always talk about dBm, dB. So everything in logarithmic scale. So that will be easy to do all the calculations. So minimum sensitivity should be the, this will be the thermal noise component. Then there is a noise figure component. Then there is a what is the required SNR. Then there is a bandwidth. So that will depend upon what sensitivity we get for the any receiver system. And there also there are a lot of wireless standards are there. This is a new old data, non-new standards also has come. So still holds good. Now still we are using Wi-Fi, so you see the data rate, what it is supporting, it's supporting till 100 Mbps and Bluetooth. So each standard having different kind of signal waveforms and even different modulation, demodulation. So anybody want to design the this RF system, they have to understand for the standard. Suppose they are designing for the Zigbee, they have to understand the Zigbee standard first. So to know what type of waveforms will come and how much amplification, what is the sensitivity for each. They will define the sensitivity, noise figure, dynamic range, possibly there. So depending on that. So you see the this scale is basically showing the range. So Zigbee is having low data rate, but it will be higher range. Bluetooth having the low data rate, but lower range only. So basically you see the Bluetooth only work for 10 to 20 meter, but we can go up to something around the 30 meter. If you see the Wi-Fi signal, it will give high data rate, but only it will work for only one room or one. And that kind of thing. So now new standard also there, which will go for very high range, like WiMAX, IEEE 802. A lot of standards are there. People are defining. So they are defining all the what type of RF and everything has to be there. So we have done some 2-3 ICs actually. Basically, one IC that we have done for the Zigbee, because we are also using for some sensor data to communicate. We have done the IEEE 802.15.4 Zigbee. So that is this. So you see the what are the specifications? This is defined by the standard. So we are standards are defined. So we have to design our circuit accordingly. So this we can't change. So the tail frequency range should be between 2.4 to 2.48. Sensitivity should be minus 80 dBm. Data should support the 50 kHz protocol channel 16. So this parameter we take as an input for our design. Then accordingly we design circuit. So let's say one parameter sensitivity minus 80 dBm. Accordingly we see what will be the total overlays noise figure we require. And number of channels 16, so this PLL has to generate our 16 channels. And IP3, IPM noise figure should be so. Basically this parameter, so we have to understand all this parameter, then we'll come to some circuit parameter. So there will be a lot of calculations will happen. Then Zigbee, so this is the Zigbee, this is multiple ages for Zigbee. And we have done once, the HTML for the satellite communication. So here also there are a lot of points there. So basically it's a transceiver. So a lot of integration has to be done. So basically this IC integrate direct from the transmitter receiver and two pickings in this IC as well satellite. So you see that there we have to design multiple. I was just showing. So in RF, new thing will come is a kind of inductor. We mostly don't use any inductor in the analog design. But when we come to the RF, there are a lot of tunability has to be done. So we required inductor. So we have to integrate inductor. So this is showing one VCO. For the VCO, it looks like it's a kind of a cross coupled VCO with LC tuned oscillator. So which will generate this frequency, different frequencies and with the phase noise. The parameter will come in picture. And then this is a PLL, which will generate the frequency component, channel and all. So this figure shows this is what the chip was designed. So we have done this thing. So this shows, this is only 5x5 chip, which is having a lot of digital for receiver, amplifier. So this is the how the chip look like. So you see this, these are the inductors basically. Inductor, then there is a capacitors. And you see this green point is mostly other transistors. So anyhow, with actually I think a lot of information I have given and become too much complex to understand all this parameter in one day slides and all. But I just try to cover what are the things are there. So basically, what is the doing for this? What is the advantage of VLSI? Basically, to reduce the number of onboard discrete components and PCB boards. So that is the first advantage of the VLSI, and it will provide more integrity. Basically, reduce size and weight. So you see the earlier phone and nowadays phone, the weight and size, how it is reducing, and also reduce the energy consumption. Earlier we have to charge multiple times. Now single charge it is going to 2 days. So basically, this is all due to the VLSI advantage. It is increasing reliability and basically standardize the system. So when we do for this chip level integration, a lot of standardization is done. So and then provide more programmability, reduce cost. So a lot of, if we go for advantages, a lot of things are there. So that's I can't count now. But this is just to give one brief hint how things should be done for our applications and how this analog IC field is a very vast field. For any designer. So with this, I want to like area. So now this is a cochlear implant. So already things are there. So, but we are now doing indigenization on this thing. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Pradeep Kumar Garu. Shall we take up a questionnaire session?
Yeah, please.
Some of them, they raise the hand.
So I have seen that actually.
I will mute them. Bharati, Madam Garu, please. I'm unmuting you.
Sir, could you tell some of the open source tools for VLSI signal processing, sir?
Yes.
Hello? Sir, could you tell some of the open source tools for VLSI
signal processing? Bharati, madam, just a minute.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just a minute.
Okay. So, what you wanted, open source tools? Actually,
tools for VLSI signal processing, sir.
So, mostly in VLSI industry, it's a very costly actually. If you see industry, so tools we are using is very costly. Okay, each tool license will cost 1 crore, 2 crore for any industry. If want to do some basic practice, suppose we want to do some basic in the CMOS design, there is one tool called LTSpice.
Okay. Sir, what about Qflow, sir? Qflow
is also there, but I just telling about the suppose you want to do basic transistor design, op-amp design, the LTSpice is a good tool for all this spectra design, analog point of view.
No, I am working on algorithm based, sir.
Algorithm for what? Means I working in which language? Verilog.
Yeah, Verilog.
Verilog. There is a one called QCUS. QCUS is there.
What, sir?
QCUS. I will tell you. Generally, we are in our industry, we are using the very standard tools which are very costly. It's not freely available. But there is what I think is one LTSpice. You can download from the. This here, you have a lot of options for transistor, gate level design, things you can do. Even though this is, I'm showing for all participants, so if you want to do some basic analog design. they can do. You just they have to just download LT Spice. They have a lot of everything components are there. You can write a lot of script also here. And then I will tell you the other tool.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Now, Suresh Pani Selvam raised the hand.
Okay.
Now unmuting him.
Hello.
Sir Suresh Pani Selvam, sir, please unmute yourself. Okay, now you take up another participant, KVKVL Pavan Kumar Garu. Please ask your question.
Sir, good evening, sir. First of all, the session is very informative, sir. Sir, one question regarding thermal noise, sir. Could you elaborate for me thermal noise in mixed signal, sir, somewhat, sir?
Actually, that's what I'm telling you. The thermal noise is not depending on the any signal. Mixed signal, basically, the thermal noise we take in care for mostly for analog design. Okay. So, in analog design, what will happen? Thermal noise, you got the idea, na? Thermal noise, there thermal noise due to the, there is a temperature, there is a random motion for electrons, which will cause the raise in the noise level. So, what will happen in the mixed signal, basically, it's not directly come as a thermal noise, but there is a kind of a coupling noise will happen. So there is some kind of switching is happening. Okay. So what it will do, basically a lot of capacitor we are using. So through this capacitor, if there is a small change in this side, there should be sudden change in, because capacitor can't change their certain voltages. So if there is a small change in this side will also be changed. Got my point? So that through this, the noise happening in the mixed signal. So mostly it's a coupling noise which is happening in the mixed signal. Thermal noise is exist in all the systems, but in digital, this due to the, because there are lot of noise similarity because due to only the switching logic has to be one and zeros. So, but analog, this thermal noise is more dominating.
Sir, we can predict that ideally in digital circuits, the thermal noise is zero.
No, that's not the thermal. Not zero, but what will happen? What are the circuits we are designing? The switching logic. Only problem what will come when we are reducing the supply voltages. Suppose if I use supply voltage of 5 volt, so because my thermal noise component is only some microvolt or nanovolt. Okay, lot of transistor. Okay. Suppose I design some circuit, so it will be integrated some microvolt. But my logic is my threshold is 2.5 volt. But suppose now if I go very low voltage, like technology, like suppose I'm my supply voltage itself is a 0.9 or 0.5 volt kind of thing. But thermal noise is still same. Okay. So my noise immunity is reducing due to this thermal noise. That's the thing. Thermal noise is always exist for all the transistors, because whatever the digital circuit also are implementing, there will be always the thermal noise component. Since only there in digital, we are assuming some values, one and zeros for, suppose for a 0.9 volt technology, below 0.45, it will be called as a zero, above 0.45, it will be called as a one. Okay. So that's why the thermal noise is not directly coming picture in a digital.
Okay, sir, you have defined that thermal noise is equal to KT by C, sir, where C is a total load capacitance only, sir?
Correct. C is a load capacitance. There is a one formula. What will happen is thermal noise, when we pass through any kind of filter, because all circuits will be kind of filtered.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So the total power inside that will be always defined by the KT by C.
Okay, sir.
So mostly this equation we use for our ADC DAC design.
Sir, I'm also working on ADC only, sir. My research is work also in SIR ADC, sir.
So basically there you have to take care of KT by C noise. Why? Because the C value we have to define, because now if you want to improve the speed, you have to reduce the speed, correct?
Sorry, sir, Japan, sir.
But if you reduce the C, what will happen? Your thermal noise will increase. So you have to optimize between sampling speed and noise.
Okay. Sir, how?
Sir, now I'm allowing.
Sir, one.
Suresh Paneer Selvam, raise the hand. Suresh Paneer Selvam, please unmute yourself. Otherwise, we go ahead with. All right. Suresh sir, please. Suresh sir, please ask the question. Okay, sir. So then we go for Srinivas Ellapu, please.
सर गुड इवनिंग सर
गुड इवनिंग
सर गुड इवनिंग सर
गुड इवनिंग बोलिए
सर इट इज वेरी इन्फॉर्मेटिव सेशन सर माय डाउट इज वेरी स्मॉल सर इन इन कॉक्लियर इम्प्लांटेशन वी आर यूजिंग वन मशीन सर सर द लाइफ टाइम ऑफ बैटरी इज हाउ मेनी डेज सर द लाइफ टाइम ऑफ बैटरी वी आर यूजिंग इन एसिक that circuit, how much long it will work, sir?
That's why I explained actually. What are the popular internal implant having no battery? Okay, but outside, now outside unit we are designing actually. So yes. There we are trying to optimize the power and all things. So, but what we are now targeting for the, it should work for the at least 10 hours. It should be work for the full day, means around 18 hours it should work.
Okay, okay. After that, we will
outside unit will be the 18 hours. Now we are targeting.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. Is it possible to recharge, sir?
That will be rechargeable. Outside unit. Now what I explained is inside unit. Inside unit there is no battery at all. We are generating power from the outside unit actually. Okay, but outside unit will be having the battery, which will be the rechargeable battery, and that we are targeting for one or two battery will work for some full day. It should work.
I hope there is no questions from audience. So now formal vote of thanks. Before that, there will be feedback poll. I request Rajashekhar garu, please put a poll. No, 1 minute, 1 minute. Dr. N. Alivelu Manga garu is raised a hand. Shall we allow them, sir, to ask a question?
Please.
Alivelu Manga garu, please unmute yourself. Please unmute your site. Okay, now I'm allowing Hamalata Dalmia. Hamalata Dalmia, please unmute yourself. So now I'm trying to unmute you, but you have to, at your end, you have to unmute. Okay, now Pawan Kumar gar again came, I think so. Now Sambamurthy gar raise your hand, now unmuting him.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Am I audible, sir?
Audible.
Sir, actually, you delivered in the PPT session everything on a single dimensional signal processing, sir. Okay, no, sir. Single level, maybe EEG signal or ECG signal, or it okay. May be that is a single dimensional signal. So coming okay. To the image, that is another two dimensional signal, sir.
Correct.
So,
okay.
By using FPGA, suppose there is an RGB signal, color signal. I want to filtering.
Okay.
Whether it may be any type of filtering, suppose during the transmission and reception purpose, there may be a random impulse noise is there. Suppose, suppose we will take an example. So the computational complexity for an 8-bit RGB 3 × 8 24-bit R3 signals, R signal, G signal, B signal,
Okay.
So we will take an 8-bit for the digital signal processing. We will take an 8-bit, 3 × 8, 24-bit. Okay. So like that, 256 × 256, 64,530 nearly. So the samples and processing time is very much high, and also the computational complexity also high. So how Fair we enough. Can how we can work on it?
Basically, I understand your doubt actually, because you are telling you a lot of signals are there and how everybody has, everything has to be processed. So actually, I tell mostly I'm working in analog, but I tell you two techniques actually which has to be operated on this thing basically. First is called is a pipelining. Okay, so in pipelining, what we will do, because my signal is, suppose let's say I am getting frequency of 1 kHz frequency or 2 kHz frequency, which RGB signals. Okay, so what I will do, some kind of multiplexing or I will do processing at 2 kHz or 3 kHz, which will process these 3 signals. Okay, so 2-3 techniques are there, kind of pipelining, multiplexing, or even though there is some kind of compression techniques are there. What it will do, compression technique, basically it will reduce the first, it will only process the redundant data. Basically, now in RGB, what will happen, there is only some bits are changing. Okay, so instead of doing processing on this 24-bit, what we will do, we'll find out which bits are mostly changing. This is suppose for some part, we have to put some algorithm to find out, suppose there is a intensity is coming or any kind of the slides are increasing, decreasing. So only some bits will be going to change. So that only. So there's kind of a looping and this predictions, a lot of algorithm has to be done. It's not like a straightforward, you have to process all this 256 signal at a time. Okay, so this type of techniques you have to search for that, and with that you think you can work out.
Hamlata madam, please unmute. Thank you. Hamlata madam, you raise your hand. I'm unmuting you. Please unmute yourself. Unmute yourself, Hamlata madam. Okay, sir, there is no, only one, Pawan Kumar sir is again, he's asking.
Let him ask.
Okay.
Sir, I have small note, sir. Sir, 1/f noise occurs only at the low frequencies, or it also be present at high frequencies also, sir?
Actually, what will happen if we processing the high frequency also, what will happen that low frequency lights will going to be up convert.
Okay.
So if you see the VCO and other thing, the space noise is also due to this low frequency noise. What will happen? We are using some bias circuit. Then it is working at high frequency, then there will be mixing will happen. So the low frequency noise will be going to up convert it to the high frequency. So that will also will happen. So it's not only
you have to consider the noise at high frequency also, sir.
So it has to be, basically what will happen, the circuits itself is converting this low frequency, and some kind of, let's say, doing multiplex, basically mixing or something, so that low frequency noise will be converted to the high frequency. Inside their circuit, self-mixing is happening, which will convert this low to high frequency. So any point of time you have to consider that, but what will happen when we directly straightforward processing the low frequency, we have to see 1/f, but then it is a modulated noise. So it will be a little bit less compared to the direct process.
Hamlata madam, please
unmute
yourself. Hamlata madam, raise the hand. Okay, I hope no questions from audience. I request all the participants. I hope Rajshekhar garu, poll is taken. రాజశేఖర్ గారు పోల్ తీసుకున్నారా హలో
సార్ తీసుకున్నాను సార్
ఓకే రైట్ థ్యాంక్ యూ ప్రదీప్ కుమార్ గారు ఫర్ యువర్ బిజీ షెడ్యూల్ బట్ యాక్సెప్టెడ్ అవర్ రిక్వెస్ట్ అండ్ డెలివర్డ్ వెరీ వండర్ఫుల్ టాక్ టుడే మోస్ట్ ఆఫ్ VLSA రీసెర్చర్స్ దే మే బి ఎంజాయ్డ్ because of analog and digital mixed IC design is not so easy today because of fight each other, analog and digital. but you are presented very well. Formally, I am requesting Mr. Anil Kumar, Assistant Professor of EC Department, Global Engineering College, say vote of thanks.
Anil sir,
sit down there. Anil Kumar garu, meer unmute cheskondi. Rajasekhar garu unmute.
Right, yes sir. Okay. Am I audible sir?
Audible. Myself
P. Anil Kumar, Assistant Professor of EC Department. I take it as a privilege to propose the vote of thanks for the today's session. First, I thank our college management for their continued support and encouragement in organizing this program in a grand manner. And I thank our college principal, Dr. P. Ravindra Babu Garu, for his everlasting support to the EC department for encouraging, for organizing this kind of programs. I thank our college vice principal academics, Dr. GSNR Prasad Garu, and vice principal administration, Dr. B. Karun Kumar Garu, team with EC department in organizing the programs of this nature. I thank the today's session speaker, Engineer Pradeep Kumar Garu, for accepting our proposal to deliver a talk in this program in spite of his busy schedule. I thank the convener of this program and the mentor of EC department, Dr. M. Kamaraj Garu, for immense support, encouragement, and guidance in each and every aspect of scheduling, organizing, and implementing this program and making it a grand success. I thank the convener of this program and the HOD of the EC department, Dr. VVKDV Prasad Garu, for support and guidance in making this program a grand success. I thank all the participants throughout the country and overseas, spread over different fields, for attending this program.
Thank you very much. Thank you for giving the opportunity. And I also like to thank everyone for having patience to
staff who are making all these requirements in offline and offline to make this program a grand success. I thank the press and media for wide coverage of this event. Last but not least, I thank the coordinators of this program, Mr. N. Sambamurthy Garu and Mr. B. Rajasekhar Garu, for organizing this event in a grand way. I thank one and all for making this event a grand success.
Thank you, Anil Kumar Garu.
All the one and all.
Thank you. I request all the participants, please unmute your video. Everyone, please make your video is on for attendance purpose only. Don't think otherwise. I request all the participants, make your video is on. I request all the participants, make your videos on. I request all the participants, make your videos on. Rajasekhar garu, andaru videos vachayandi. Rajasekhar garu, andaru videos vachaya? Okay. Okay. Pradeep Kumar garu, shall we close the session?
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, first, I would like to thank everyone. Thank you very much. If anything, I will share my mail ID to Raju sir. If you can, even though whatever the presentation I can share, I will share with him.
Okay.
Okay. So I will send you the mail. So you just share to other participants.
Okay. Sure, sir.
Okay. Sure. Good day, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Stay safe, stay at home. All the best to everyone. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Ashekar garu, session end cheyandi. Some of the participants are giving their mobile names and all. I request a participant to give your name while logging Zoom. Sir, tomorrow we'll begin at 5 o'clock. The session, the speaker will begin 5:30. Tomorrow onwards, there is a 2 speakers every day. I request all the participants to bear with us. They're all from industry. There is 2 speakers tomorrow onwards. Ashekar garu,
yes sir.
Meeting end cheyandi.
Sare sir.
Chudandi feedback andre vachindha ledha check cheskondi.
Ah, vachindi sir.
Okay, right. Thank you, Rashik.
Thank you. Ha, thank you.